Previously, we have seen how we can use the Paxos algorithm as some example of a consensus algorithm to agree on the execution order of requests to a state machine in order to achieve a correct state machine replication. Now we will look at the ordering of events using timestamps, or basically clocks, you can say. And these timestamps then indicating an ordering, and hence we can achieve also here, if we agree that timestamps are used in a way that the order is globally known, then also we can have a correct state machine replication. Let's have a look at one process. Here we talk now about events. Later on, these events, you can say they are actions or commands issued by users. But this is like the notion that Lamport used to introduce these timestamps. So we have one process, and there is a sequence of events happening, A, B, C, D in our example here. And of course, we can look at this sequence, which imposes already the order, and can see that A happens before B, and B happens before C, and so on. And of course, also A happens before C, and B happens before D, and so on. So what we want to do is define a happens before relation that we write down using this arrow here. And the trick is to get this definition also done for multiple processes. So we can think about like a distributed system with multiple processes or multiple nodes. So here's the definition of this relation happens before. Let's say you look at events, sets of events, E, and you're computing the Cartesian product, then this relation is simply a subset or equal to this Cartesian product. Like for relation, it is usually the case or always the case. Now, the first bullet point here means the illustration from the previous slide. If A and B are events in the same process, and A comes before B in the sequence on this process, then also A happens before B. The second one is now what we do with multiple processes. Here we define this happens before across sending and receiving of messages. If A is the sending of a message by one process and B is the receipt of the same message by another process, then A happens before B. So here's a process, here's another one. Here, this is like the first bullet point, right? Happens before B. And this here is the second bullet point. We have here sending and receiving. And then we can say if this is, let's say, A, B, C, and this is X, let's say, then we know now A happens before C, of course, by the bullet point one, and B before C, but we also know that B happens before X. And third, we have transitivity. If A happens before B and B happens before C, then we know A happens before C. Yeah, in this illustration here, we have A happens before X by this transitivity. Two distinct events are called concurrent if we cannot state that A happens before B, and we cannot state that B happens before A. Here's an illustration from the paper by Lamport. We see the arrows here indicating the relation. We have here on process P, event P1, sending, receiving is here at Q2. So we know that P1 happens before Q2. And by transitivity, we know also P1 happens before Q3, Q4, Q5, and so on. And we also have concurrent, of course, events. For instance, we have here Q1 and R1 are, of course, concurrent. Instead of this definition, we also can rephrase a little the definition of happens before. We can also say we have a meaning of causally affecting. That means if you have this A happens before B, that means it is possible for an event A to affect the event B. For instance, if you have in event B some calculation and A happens before B, then it can be that the outcome of the calculation in the event B is influenced by some calculation done in the event A. Two events are concurrent if neither can causally affect the other, right? So now how can we come from the happened before relation to our timestamps, our logical clocks, or called Lamport timestamps? Simply, we let every node keep an integer count and increment this count at each atomic event. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and here is the same 1, 2, 3 until 8. And what happens if these processes are sending and receiving? Well, when sending and receiving, the receiver adapts the clock to the received clock plus 1. If the own clock is not larger already than this value. So here we have in the event A descending to process 1. So here we have the value 8 plus 1, which is 9. So we have this effect happening as defined here. And in the other case here we have the clock 10. There's descending taking place, but we have already here anyway the clock value of 11, so nothing happens here. So how can we now make use of these Lamport timestamps? Which properties do we have? So let's say we have an event X, which happens before event Y. So X and Y can be on the same process, or X is sending and Y is receiving. Then X, or the clock of X, is smaller than the clock of Y. This means that if we have X happens before Y, then we know that the clock of X is strictly smaller than the clock of Y. This is called clock condition in Lamport's paper. However, and this is important to remember also for exams, it does not hold the other way around, that if we know that the clock of X is smaller than the clock of Y, that this implies that X happens before Y. This is important. And it is easy to illustrate or to see why this is not holding if you're drawing a little example. And we will later see that we have a measure to do this, a clock to do this, but not the simple clocks, but we have to do a bit more fancy stuff when we introduce so-called vector clocks. The relation happens before, as defined earlier, is only a partial order. We have to break ties stemming from concurrent events. In order to do this, we do a little trick. We assume that we have a total order between the processes. And then we are defining a total order happens before, indicated by this different arrow, as follows. If A is an event in process PI and B is an event in process PJ, then A happens before B, if and only if one of these two is true. First one is clear. If the clock of A is smaller than the clock of B, then it happens before. Okay. However, if we have here the second condition, that the clock value is equal, then we use the total order between the processes to break this tie. And now, how can we use these clocks to build our replicated state machine? Well, the idea is simple. We have now an order defined, a total order, between these different events, so the different actions in our system, and all we need is to have the replicated state machines executing these events or these actions in this order, right? And since the order is total, then the replicated state machine should work as they should, right? As one machine, of course, the actions have to be deterministic as before, and also they have to have the same starting state, but here we are concerned about the order. The only little problem is that we need so-called stability. So we want to process at each of these replicated state machines the next stable request with lowest identifier. The problem here is, and this is what stable means, the problem is that if we look at one if you look at one state machine, and let's say the smallest timestamp, or the action with the smallest timestamp, has timestamp 5, then we can process this 5 only if we know that it cannot happen that there is some action coming in with timestamp 4, right? Because then we would have a big problem. So we have to make sure that this 5, if it's our lowest timestamp that we did not yet execute, we only execute if we know that there cannot be anything smaller coming from any other process. So how does this work? How can we reach this? First of all, we have these processes, so our state machines are the processes, and they're receiving commands by users, and they're broadcasting these commands to all the other state machines. So there is, of course, a constant broadcasting going on, but in order to have stability, we need to have all these processes to broadcast regularly. So after a fixed amount of time, it has to be a broadcast. Now, in case there is no user command that we can broadcast, we just make up some dummy message. And this is important to understand why, in order to reach this ability, and we will see that on the next slide. So how is this implemented? Look at one process I. This process maintains a vector that we'll call known time. Let's say we have three processes. Process 1, 2, 3. Let's say we have known time 12, 10, and 7. So these are the times we have received from these individual processes. And these times mean these are the largest logical times we ever have seen from these processes. So now we look in this process I at one command pi. And we have to check if we can execute now this command pi in our local state machine. In order to be able to execute pi, both of the following conditions have to be fulfilled. The first one is very simple. This pi has to have the smallest logical time of any command that we know of not applied yet in our process I. Okay? Because we say we want to process these commands ordered by the time, right? This should be clear for everyone. Now, second criteria, this is now about this ability. We can only execute this. Of course, this has to be true, right? But in addition, for every process J, the known time of J in our array here, in our vector, is at least as large as the logical time of pi. So if pi is 5, let's say, then it's fine. We can execute it because the messages are assumed to arrive in order and we have already received a 7. So that means if 5 is not yet applied, we can go ahead, right? And of course, we have not only seen 7, but 10 from the other process and 12 from the other process. So it is safe now to apply 5. However, if this would be, let's say, a different value, let's say it is 9. So 9 is the smallest value not yet applied. Then we cannot execute it yet because there could be still coming something from process 3 that has timestamp 8 and would need to be executed before pi with timestamp 9, right? This is what we need to ensure. And if both are fulfilled, we can execute pi. And this makes our replicated state machine to work correctly.